We just saw that model averaging may be a very wise thing to do, but instead of averaging over models that are obtained by different data sets, we're going to average parametric models over different parameter sets, where each model is weighted with the posterior probability for the corresponding parameters. Now, this is called Bayesian regression, as we saw in a couple of videos back, and we're picking up this direction again in the upcoming videos. Now, we will again be parameterizing our distributions via Gaussians, since as we have seen so far, these Gaussian functions are very convenient to work with, and this remains so the case when we move to the full Bayesian framework. Okay, now let's quickly go over the probabilistic setting again. So we're dealing with data, input-output pairs, and we're going to put all our observed data variables in this data matrix X and the corresponding targets in one target vector T. Now our goal is again to recover the probability distribution that may have generated this data. So we're going to work with predictive distributions. Now with these predictive distributions, again, given an input data point X prime, predict the probability for the corresponding target value. And such a probability distribution is going to be parameterized by a set of weights W and some hyperparameter beta, which is the precision of our distribution. And we're going to model these likelihoods via normal distributions. So we're going to model this with a normal distribution with respect to T prime, centered around some mean, which is given by this linear model, which maps an input X prime to the corresponding target mean via a basis function and a weight. And then centered around this mean is this Gaussian blob with a certain precision. Right, so this precision is the inverse variance of the normal distribution. Okay, let me just write this down. So this part, the mean prediction is given by our model, right? So a model that maps an input X prime to a corresponding target mean via these weight parameters. So this likelihood gives the likelihood for a single data point, right? A single data point pair given my model parameters W and precision a beta, which is a hyperparameter. Now we always assume that our data is IID, so it's independently identically distributed according to the same type of distribution over here. So that also means that the likelihood for my entire data set was given by the product of all these individual likelihoods. And now you can show that if my individual likelihood is given by a single Gaussian, then the joint likelihood for all these data points together can also be formulated as a normal distribution, now a multivariate normal distribution that gives the likelihood for all these target values together, given the mappings from my inputs to the corresponding means, and each output target variable has the same uncertainty beta. So my covariance matrix will be a diagonal, so the identity matrix times beta inverse. Now recall that this capital phi was the design matrix. So it was my basis functions evaluated on all data points. So one row is all basis functions evaluated for one data point, and then all these rows represent all of these data points, where the columns represent one basis function. So what you see over here is row vector multiplication. So each basis function is multiplied with the corresponding weight. So for each data point, I make a prediction for the target, right? So this thing maps each data point to the corresponding mean value that's given by here. And then for each data point, I also have an uncertainty, which is for every direction in this vector the same, meaning that for every around every point, I have the same uncertainty beta inverse. Now, this is actually not too hard to show that the joint likelihood can be written as a multivariate Gaussian, but I encourage you to verify this yourself in case you do not believe me. Okay, now in this posterior framework, we want to also assign the probability of a certain set of parameters W. So in the end, we're interested in this posterior distribution, like, what is the probability that my model should take on this set of parameters given my observed data? And we're getting there via the Bayes rule, and this relies on the definition of a prior. So we first make a prior assumption of this is what the weights are going to look like, and we are again going to model this with a Gaussian distribution. So basically this says that my model parameters W's are most likely to take on the values described by mean of my Gaussian distribution, and I have some uncertainty in these parameters described via this covariance matrix. And a small note regarding notation, I'm going to denote here zero. So this is the mean and the covariance of my data matrix without observing any data points. So that's the zero. Okay, so now I have a likelihood given by a Gaussian distribution, and I have a prior given by a Gaussian distribution. And the posterior is obtained by the product of these two Gaussian distributions. Right, this is a Gaussian, this is a Gaussian, and this is just a constant. Okay, so I'm multiplying two Gaussians here, and it turns out that the product of two Gaussians will again give me a Gaussian. And this Gaussian will be of the form like this. So it's again a Gaussian with respect to W now, parameterized by a mean, and which has some covariance matrix Sn. And now, given my likelihood with this mean and this covariance, and given my prior with this mean and this covariance, you can show that the resulting product of the likelihood and the prior is given by a Gaussian with these parameter sets. And the derivation is done in Bishop 2.116. Now, I do not expect you to memorize these rules of combining two Gaussians, but the principle, like the idea that if I take the product of two Gaussians, that it will give me a new Gaussian, that is something that you really should get familiar with. You can sort of see why this happens, right? So consider, for example, the univariate case, so a 1D Gaussian. So a Gaussian is really an exponential e to the power minus and then some quadratic form there. If I multiply it with another e to the power, some quadratic form, I get, well, I sum the exponents. So I get e to the power, well, again, something which is quadratic with respect to these variables. Now, these kind of derivations then rely on a technique such as complete the squares, which you may be familiar with from your calculus course. Basically, it means if I have a quadratic, like a polynomial, I can always write it into this quadratic form that you see in the exponential of a Gaussian. And this is basically what they did in the Book of Bishop in chapter 2 for the multivariate Gaussian case. And it will give you this result. So I really encourage you to take a look at chapter 2.3, which talks about how to combine Gaussians and shows how this is done. And this will definitely give you a feeling of how these equations are derived. But the main point here again is, and this is what you should remember, that if I have a Gaussian and another Gaussian, I take the product, then this gives me a new Gaussian. And this gives me a new Gaussian in which the means and the covariance matrices are obtained in a particular way. This is what I show over here, but this is not something that you have to remember per se. We will give this if that's necessary. Okay, with that being said, I want to introduce the notion of a conjugate prior. It's written over here. So really this means I could also pick other distributions, but the Gaussians are very convenient to work with. Now, suppose I have a likelihood parameterized in some form and via some family of distributions. We choose Gaussian distributions. Then sometimes you have a so-called conjugate prior, which means that if I multiply my likelihood with a prior, I obtain a posterior distribution, which is in the same family of distributions as my likelihood and my prior. So in that sense, you can think of a conjugate prior as a prior which is compatible with the type of distribution which I'm going to work with. So in this case, it means I have a likelihood, which is a normal distribution, and my conjugate prior, which is compatible with this, is also a Gaussian distribution. And because it's a conjugate prior, I obtain a prior in the same family of distributions, namely also, again, a Gaussian. Okay, so this is super nice. We work with Gaussians and we stick with working with Gaussians, and that means that we always can obtain these analytic forms. So my posterior is really this analytic form which I have over here, and it's a Gaussian and it has nice properties, meaning that if I want to compute the maximum posterior estimate, so I know from Gaussians where to expect the maximum value will be around the mean, or will be exactly at the mean. So this immediately gives me the maximum posterior estimate, namely given by this mean, which is derived over here, and which we're going to take a closer look at in the upcoming slides. Now let's take a look at a special case, at a simple special case. So suppose my prior is again a normal distribution, so it's a conjugate prior for my weights. It's a prior for my weights, and I assume that my weights are going to be centered around zero, but I allow them to deviate from zero. So I have this precision parameter or covariance, which is diagonal, right? So I basically assume independence along all my weights. Okay, then given my likelihood and my prior, given now in this way, I obtain a formula for the posterior distribution. So I obtain a normal distribution whose mean is given in the following way. And now, since the mean of my prior was zero, this thing isn't there. So I obtain a mean in the following form. Beta times Sn, the design matrix transpose T. And similarly, we get an expression for the covariance matrix. And this is given then by alpha I plus beta phi transpose phi, right? Because here we have to compute the inverse of my prior covariance matrix, which was a diagonal matrix. So it's just the inverse over its diagonal elements, which was alpha inverse. So I get this alpha over here. Okay, so this gives me a nice analytic form for the posterior distribution. It's just a formula that we can evaluate. And I'm just going to write it out to remind you of what such a multivariate Gaussian looks like. So it's this front factor, 2 pi to the power m times the determinant of my covariance matrix and the square root of this thing. So this is my front factor, then e to the power minus a half, well, my weight parameter minus the mean, so relative to this mean, times the covariance matrix inverse times w minus the mean. So this shows you that there's really no magic to it. The posterior is just a formula that we can evaluate. And we also have ways of explicitly computing the mean and the covariance of this Gaussian distribution. Okay, now let's take a look at a limiting case to get a feeling of what these kind of distributions look like in some extreme cases. So I'll be considering the case of an infinitely broad prior. So it essentially means that there's no restriction on W. Remember that my prior was given as follows. So I assumed it to be centered around zero. And then there's this variance assumed in my model, in my prior. Oh, and there should actually be an N over here. So when alpha goes to zero, I have this very wide, this infinitely wide Gaussian distribution saying that I'm completely unsure what my parameter value W is going to be. Okay, so I'm computing the limit when alpha goes to zero of my newly obtained mean. So that's really taking this limit over here. Alpha is here, this is an identity matrix, so this term will go to zero, and what I'm left is with just this. So in the limit alpha goes to zero, I have beta over beta, right, where I took this beta outside of this inverse, so that gives me beta times beta inverse, and this one cancels out. And now I hope that you recognize this formula, because we've seen this before. I hope you recognize this solution as the maximum likelihood solution. So this is really nice. So this basically means that if in my posterior case, in this probabilistic setting, if I make my assumption is basically that I do not know anything about my prior, I have no prior information, then this this posterior solution converges to the maximum likelihood solution. Okay, so in the limit when alpha goes to zero, my mean of my predictive distribution will be given by the maximum likelihood solution. Okay, now let's approach this in the other direction. Now suppose I consider the infinitely narrow prior. So basically, I let alpha goes to infinity. So that means I'm completely sure about what my weights are going to be. This is, again, a normal distribution. So I'm going to say my normal of my weights are going to be centered around zero. And I'm very confident of this. Okay, so let's take this limit. So the limit of alpha goes to zero. Let's look at the mean. Then I'm look at the limit of alpha goes to infinity. So that means this term is going to dominate. And that tells me that I'm taking the limit of alpha goes to infinity of beta over alpha phi transpose t. And since alpha is going to infinity, this term will decay to zero. Okay, so in the limit, my average will indeed be zero. And this was the case because, well, my prior assumption was that the weights were centered around MN is zero. Now, similarly, in the case of the covariance matrix, I'm actually taking the limit of alpha goes to infinity of 1 over alpha, the identity matrix, right? Because this term is going to dominate. This is the identity matrix. And I'm taking the inverse. I can take the alpha outside. So that gives me this. So this actually means that I will obtain the zero matrix. So my covariance in this limit will be given by the zero matrix. So really this tells me if I set alpha to zero, then I just obtain the solution zero. My weights are going to be zero. Because the mean of the distribution will converge to zero, and also the covariance matrix will converge to zero. So basically it's going to say I do not allow for any deviation from zero. Okay, so we just saw that if we work with Gaussian distribution, so both for the likelihood as for the prior, we obtain a posterior distribution, which is also a Gaussian, and we can find analytic expression for what the mean and the covariance of these Gaussians will be. That's given here in the top right. Okay, and we also nicely saw that in the limiting case when alpha goes to zero, so I do not incorporate any prior knowledge because I'm fully uncertain about my what my prior weights are going to be, then it sees that we're going, then we see that we're going to rely on the data fully, and we obtain that the maximum posterior distributions are nicely centered around the maximum likelihood solutions.